Good afternoon. Welcome to today's Grand Rounds presentation. Please remember to fill out the attendance record, and also please remember to fill out the program evaluation. And to be consistent, I'll once again ask you to give us any ideas that you might have in regards to future topics and future speakers. Our topic today, I think, is an important one. Our speaker is Dr. Rakshak Sarda. Dr. Sarda is board certified in internal medicine and cardiology, and also holds additional certifications in advanced heart failure and cardiac transplantation, echocardiography, vascular medicine, and nuclear cardiology. He's here to discuss heart failure treatment, and please join me in welcoming Dr. Sarda.
Thank you. You guys can hear me. Today we'll talk about heart failure. I would like other topics because this is very boring, so be awake. Second thing, I wanted to play it safe, so no jokes today. No financial disclosures pertaining to this presentation, and slides were obtained from Heart Failure Society of America, and I kind of put in some of my slides and modified them, so they get the credit too. Now, definition of heart failure. Heart failure is a syndrome. It can be defined in many, many ways. You open a textbook, there will be a new definition. But for our practical purposes, let's think about this as a syndrome which is caused by cardiac dysfunction. And dysfunction can be from many ways. It can be loss of myocardium. It can be just simply the muscle not working, or muscle may be thick. Something happening to the cardiac muscle causes heart failure. Usually, it is, you see fluid retention, shortness of breath, and initially patients may present with fatigue, usually with fatigue with exertion. So it's a very broad variety of symptoms patients can present, so we have to be very careful about it. It can present with, or most likely it presents with dilated LV or a thick LV, but we will talk about one presentation which is heart failure with preserved LV function later during the presentation. If left untreated, it will progress. Even if we treat, it will progress, but rate of progression would be slow. But if left treated, it will progress, clinical symptoms will happen, and we have to be careful about it. Now, severity of clinical symptoms are usually pretty predictable, but cardiac dysfunction, the way we see it morphologically or phenotypically, may not be the presentation symptom, so we have to be careful about that. So if the patient comes, EF is 45%, we should not just blow it off. It can be still a heart failure syndrome. Now, one thing is, although wherever you read it is progressive, it is fatal. But if you treat it, we can stabilize the situation. We can make the situation better. And therapy is very, very important, and today Dr. Hallberg wanted me to talk to you about what is guideline-based therapy. So we'll only stick to the guideline-based therapy today. Now, what is in physiological terms, and in cath lab which we'll look at it, is if the diastolic filling pressures are high or the cardiac filling pressures are high. So that has to be in heart failure. And the other thing is there is not enough delivery of the blood or oxygen, we should say, to the peripheral tissue, which is what causes fatigue at rest or during exercise. And again, as we talked about, this is because of cardiac dysfunction. So anything else, we are not talking about. The fatigue maybe has some other reasons also, but when it is because of cardiac dysfunction, it's in heart failure. So if it is reduced LV ejection fraction, and it's most, that is most commonly associated with LV chamber dilatation. And if the LV function is fine, then what LV ejection function is fine, then it is heart failure with what we call preserved LV function. The old name was diastolic heart failure. Usually diastolic heart failure, the chamber dilatation is not there. You may see hypertrophy, and many a times it is valvular disease or metabolic diseases. So before we come to the treatment, we talk about prevention. Once the disease sets in, it's progressive and fatal. So prevention is very, very important. And there are known or potential risk factors for heart failure. And these are all traditional bread and butter for cardiology, internal medicine, family practice: hypertension, hyperlipidemia, atherosclerosis, diabetes, valvular heart disease, obesity, physical inactivity, excessive alcohol intake, smoking, family history. These we have to assess in each patient at the first visit and in consecutive visits also. Then we have to have a thorough clinical investigation assessment. And our goal is to prevent LV dysfunction, LV remodeling, and heart failure. Once it sets in, it's progressive, it's fatal. I didn't put the slides where they say, these many people are there, it's $21 billion, $30 billion. You have all heard that it's the one of the biggest drain on Medicare, means drain on our national budget, means drain on our nation. So we have to be very careful. This slide, which is also in your handouts, suffices what our goals. So hypertension, blood pressure less than 130 over 80. And here there are a lot of nurses and our support staff. When the patient's blood pressure is 140 over 90, it's not okay. So please don't tell the patient your blood pressure is fine. It's not okay. Anything above 130 over 80 predisposes you for heart failure. So blood pressure below that. Diabetes, you can look at the ADA guidelines. Hyperlipidemia, just look at the NCEP guidelines, and they will change a little bit in the coming days. You have to have 20 to 30 minutes of aerobic activity 3 to 5 times a week. That is one of the important preventive aspects. Weight reduction less than BMI of less than 30. Now you will hear about obesity paradox and all those things, but those are mainly theoretical basis and all those things. But for epidemiological purposes, BMI less than 30 would be better. Alcohol, I know most of you will not like it. Men, less than 2 drinks per day, and women, less than 1 drink per day. This is for prevention. Once the cardiomyopathy sets in, I would even discourage this much of alcohol. I would discourage all alcohol, in fact. Smoking cessation should be advised in every visit, and they nowadays rate us with that, and pretty soon the payments would be also based on that. And dietary sodium restriction of 2 to 3 grams per day. We can keep on stressing these things, and the next time the patient comes and say, "Doc, you never told us to do that." But that's okay, they will keep on telling this, but we have to keep on stressing. Again, usual common sense, our preventive, whether it's preventive cardiology, heart failure, preventive medicine, these are the things which we have to do. What is important is if we treat hypertension, it reduces the risk of heart failure by 50%. Tremendous, tremendous, just simply treating blood pressure brings down the national debt by $15 billion. You can vote for anybody then, right? And if it is diabetes, it's in some studies 56 to 60% rate of reduction of onset of heart failure. If you have a prior MI, you rate it by 80%. You decrease the risk of heart failure if you control blood pressure by 80%. So it's extremely important. Blood pressure is an extremely important factor here. Now, prevention of heart failure, we do not have much things, but this is the common thing. ACE inhibitors and beta blockers are two drugs which have been known to improve outcomes overall. ACE inhibitors, and if ACE inhibitors, you cannot use it. ARBs are not very, very much used. I see a lot of patients every single time who are at risk of heart failure who can be given ACE inhibitors or an ARB, and they are not on it. So if you have coronary artery disease, peripheral vascular disease, stroke, diabetes, so these are the people, if possible, please put them on ACE inhibitors or an ARB. And if you have a prior MI, beta blocker. Now, there will be some studies you will be hearing in the coming guidelines and also in JNC8 and all those things, what's the role of beta blocker, and there's a lot of movement, and people who are reading journals recently would see that there are some articles coming out that beta blocker with normal systolic function and prior MI may not be that useful. This is the data from before the reperfusion era, and data after reperfusion era, if there is no damage, a person comes in 30 minutes, maybe beta blockers may not be that useful. Otherwise, for all practical purposes, guidelines still say use beta blockers if there is a prior MI. If you see, these are two important trials, HOPE trial with ramipril and Europa trial. If you see, the placebo and ramipril arms quickly separate. And these are, and the separation keeps on going. So this is a decrease in MI, stroke, and death. So usually, if you read a cardiology study, these are usually the primary endpoints, MI, death, and stroke. And it is in all three, it is important. It's significant. Also, if you look at the Europa trial with perindopril, again, very, very significant. So, and when are we doing this? 2000, 2003. So it's 10 years, 13 years ago this information came. So we need to now use these drugs, which are extremely important and very, very useful. If you look at SAVE study, now my mentor was a part of the SAVE study and they solved and all these trials. And again, it was published in 1992. All-cause mortality decreased by captopril, and we are not using captopril because of three-time dosing, 19%, CV mortality, 21%, heart failure development, nearly 35%, 37%, recurrent MI, 25%. Very cheap medications, extremely cheap medications, fairly reasonably well-tolerated, underused. So please use these. Now, when I was in my residency, this article came in 2001 about carvedilol in post-MI patient. Again, if your ejection fraction is less than 40% post-MI, you are receiving your ACE inhibitors, your dual antiplatelet therapy, all other statins, aspirin, all other therapies, and you give carvedilol, there is a all-cause mortality is reduced, cardiovascular mortality is reduced, and recurrent non-fatal MIs are reduced. So extremely important, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers in prevention of heart failure, whether it is symptomatic, whether it's post-MI, remember these drugs. Now, what do you do to assess patients with heart failure? So routine, we assess their severity and functional limitation, and that is by NYHA, New York Heart Association classification 1, 2, 3, and 4. That is the functional class. So there is a difference between staging of heart failure and functional class. Staging is A, B, C, D, and functional class is 1, 2, 3, 4, and depending upon how much you can do. The data usually is in for class 3 and class 4 heart failure, where class 4 is you can hardly do anything or dyspnea at rest, and class 3, even with the moderate activities of daily living, you will get symptoms. We have to determine the etiology of the heart failure, and for that, there's another lecture. We have to assess the cardiac structure function, and the echocardiogram is the cheapest, best available tool. There are some echocardiographers here in the audience. The importance of LV wall thickness, the importance of LV size, we cannot stress more because of these parameters, we formulate our treatment plans. And then the consistency of those measurements, which will help us determine the treatment plans on these people. Evaluation of coronary artery disease, usually ischemia, which can be non-invasive or invasive methods depending upon the situation, and the risk of life-threatening arrhythmias. This is very important. If we miss these, people are dead before giving us any clue or any symptoms. Identifying exacerbating factors for heart failure, and what's the most common factor for heart failure exacerbation is dietary non-compliance. Second is medical non-compliance. Identify comorbid conditions, because that will influence therapy. If a patient has renal dysfunction, patient has COPD, asthma, any peripheral vascular disease. So we have to identify the comorbid conditions. And identify barriers to adherence and compliance. With all these things going on about readmission rates, about payment cuts and all those things, these would become the most important thing about what are the barriers to adherence and compliance. We can use a 6-minute walk test, which is not being used much, but you will see that it will come in practice more and more at our levels. And a BNP is a very good tool for initial assessment of patients with heart failure. Now, follow-up assessments are signs and symptoms, and they should be evaluated during initial visit and every visit, and that's where we make our treatment plans. Functional capacity, that is NYHA classification, and body weight changes. Do patients understand what we are telling them about dietary sodium restriction, about medical regimen? And most of the time you will see, okay, we are putting the same point over and over again. History of arrhythmias, ask about palpitations, any syncope, presyncope, any ICD discharges, that will be very important. And adherence and response to therapeutic interventions, we have to evaluate them. Usually, if the patient is coming back, we try to see if there is any more ischemia, so we may have to ischemia evaluation. We see a lot of times that the patient who present our patients with hypertension and new or worsening valvular disease. So echocardiogram becomes important, physical examination, etc. So let's come to the treatment parts, and we'll go through the data, what's behind these things. Now, one thing is very interesting. For last 10 years, we do not have anything new, good drug approved for heart failure. So what I'm telling you is all old news. But again, we need to reiterate these things because we are still seeing that we do, by the way, my daughter decided because tomorrow is Valentine's Day, this picture should be there. So pharmacological therapy. So let's start with ACE inhibitors. So they are recommended that every patient should be on an ACE inhibitor, whether symptomatic or asymptomatic, if the ejection fraction is less than 40%. And the chart police is here, and they will make you do that. ACE inhibitors should be titrated to doses used in clinical trials. They just simply want, our chart police wants a patient is on ACE inhibitor or not. That's it. And that's what the government is looking at. But they should be titrated, and we should try hard to titrate them. And there will be some problems. We'll talk about it. So where does this data come from? If you look at here, 1992, 20 years ago, SOLVE trial, and they had SOLVE prevention, which was in asymptomatic patients, and SOLVE treatment, which was in chronic heart failure patients, both 20%, 29%, 16% mortality reduction. Very, very strong data about that. If you look at the consensus trial, which were class 3, class 4, severe congestive heart failure patient, 40% mortality reduction in 6 months. This was groundbreaking at that time. People were dying, and as soon as they gave this little medication, little pill, it changed as much. 31% mortality at 1 year, and it continued to 27% mortality at end of study. So it's very, very important that 1992 we started this process. What are the drugs which has been shown? They are captopril, enalapril, fosinopril. All these prills have been shown. And if you look at that, and this is in your handout, this is our target dose, and this is where we were able to get in the clinical trials. Now, lisinopril, if you see, there were two dosages studies. One was low dose and one was high dose, and they were pretty much the same. Mortality difference was pretty much the same. What to do if the patients are intolerant to ACE inhibitors? So if the patients are intolerant to ACE inhibitors, ARBs are recommended. If we cannot give ARBs, then hydralazine and nitrates, and we'll come to that. And if you have hyperkalemia or renal insufficiency because of ACE inhibitor, please do not use ARBs. Let's talk about beta blockers. They are to be used in symptomatic and asymptomatic patients in less than, LVEF less than 40%. And be sure that you have a beta blocker on them, if possible, if there's a prior MI and EF less than 40%. So this, I put it again, is in post-MI patients, if you do not have beta blockers, we will be dinged on our quality measures. Now, effect of beta blockade on outcome of patients with heart failure, if you look at it, we have US carvedilol study, we have bisoprolol study with CBIS-2, merit heart failure, which is with metoprolol, succinate, and Copernicus and Capricorn. And there was one trial between metoprolol and carvedilol called COMET trial, which also showed the carvedilol was a little better. But overall, the treatment target doses in the studies were this. And if you see 35 to 40% mortality benefit, so our primary endpoint benefit. So these are the beta blockers we should be using. And that will be carvedilol, bisoprolol, metoprolol, succinate. So if the patient is on metoprolol tartrate, that doesn't count. You have to have on metoprolol succinate. Which one is missing here? Okay. So carvedilol, metoprolol, succinate, and bisoprolol are the approved ones. Now, what to do, and these are general considerations, what to do if a patient has come with a recent decompensation. First thing we need to do is optimize volume status. Don't mess with anything else before we do optimization of volume status. And how do you do? That is with IV diuretics, and we'll come to that. Once we have volume status stabilized, then we use vasoactive agents. And we should start beta blocker therapy, if possible, at a low dose in the hospital prior to discharge. That is the recommendations from the Heart Failure Society of America. Now, continuation is in patients who are experiencing symptomatic exacerbation of heart failure should be there, unless and until we have cardiogenic shock, refractory volume overload, we cannot get the fluid off, or symptomatic bradycardia. And we see sometimes patients who are having lower blood pressure still on beta blockers. These should not be given because the studies have shown poor outcomes in this. And temporary dose reduction should be considered, but avoid abrupt discontinuation. We all are guilty of it. 25 BID of carvedilol, patient comes here, we don't put them on carvedilol, and they have the rebound. So avoid abrupt discontinuation. And again, reinstate gradually, and most likely we are able to, if the volume status is fine, we should be able to titrate it up very fast. Even in this Copernicus trial, they thought that the patients are real tolerant and they gave beta blockers, they did better. So we can handle them very safely, okay? So the questions which are asked is, you can use it in this caution in patients with diabetes with recurrent hypoglycemia, because there will be a problem if they are having recurrent hypoglycemia. And if there is asthma or resting limb ischemia, be very, very careful, and sometimes we discontinue them. If you have marked bradycardia, patients should be in the hospital, they should be on the monitor, we make sure that they are not decompensating, otherwise we have to stop them. And if the systolic or marked hypotension, again, that is a problem. Do not give in patients with asthma with active bronchospasm. You can give beta blockers who have history of asthma but do not have active bronchospasm. But if it is an active bronchospasm, don't give beta blocker. These are two studies which are very well quoted. One is Copernicus, one is Merit Heart Failure Trial. And in diabetics, whether you are diabetic or not diabetic, this side is better, this side is worse. All the lines are here, nothing is crossing. So in diabetes, you can give safely beta blockers and they and the patients do much better. So to sum up beta blockers, we can say initiate at low doses, uptitrate gradually. There's no rush, no hurry here. And at least to 2 weeks, unless and until you are dealing with rapid ventricular rates. Otherwise, give it 2 weeks. These are neurohormonal agents. Give them some time. And try to get to the target doses. And sometimes patients don't like that, but at least uptitrate. If they are not liking it, we can always downtitrate. And usually it takes around 12 weeks to reach to the target doses. So they have to be seen quite often. Patients are tired, we are tired, but they have to be seen quite often. And try to maintain at the maximum tolerated doses. If symptoms worsen, first work on diuretics, and then work on vasoactives. And if uptitration continues to be difficult, then you can, instead of 2 weeks, you can make it 4 weeks, 6 weeks, but get them in. And you can say, okay, I'm going to be happy with 12.5 BID of carvedilol in this patient, and that will be the max, and you can document it that we have tried it multiple times. And this is a little bit of commercial. You can refer the patients to us. So again, used in clinical trials, we went over this site. I want to make sure that we do it again. Otherwise, we will be dinged. I still see patients on labetalol, on etinolol, on metoprolol tartrate with low EFs now and then. Let's make sure that we don't do that. Now, ARBs. Where are ARBs used? ARBs are used in symptomatic and asymptomatic patients with LVEF of less than 40%. Again, the same indication what the ACE inhibitors are. But they are to be used in patients who are intolerant to ACE inhibitors for reasons other than hyperkalemia and renal insufficiency. The two trials, Walhaft and Charm alternative trials, were used in these patients. At one point in my career, I was working as a research coordinator for Charm trial, and they both showed improvements. So we can safely use ARBs in the patients who we are not using ACE inhibitors. Now, losartan and valsartan are generic, and their use in heart failure would increase because we have a lot of patients who have intolerance because of cough with ACE inhibitors. So we have candesartan, losartan, valsartan, which are three drugs which we can use. The most studies are with valsartan and candesartan. Candesartan is still, I think, not generic yet. Before I go there, let's make sure that most of the heart failure treatment, or I said almost all of the heart failure treatment drugs, are generic. So our patients should be able to afford them, or we should be able to find the drugs for them. Sometimes there may be an issue, and I had the issue with eplerenone, which we'll come to it now. But they are very cheap drugs. Now, where do we use aldosterone antagonists? These are on people who are on standard therapy, means ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, diuretics, and who have class 4 heart failure symptoms, or who had prior class 4 heart failure symptoms and now class 3. So all our patients who are admitted to the hospitals have class 4 heart failure. So any patient who is discharged and is in class 3 heart failure, ejection fraction less than 35% should be on aldosterone antagonist. And if you have a prior MI or post-MI, less than 40%. The data comes from Rawls trial. This was, again, the same time I was in my residency when we have the Rawls trial. And these were published from University of Michigan. And they showed that the curves separate very fast. And there was a tremendous survival benefit, one-third survival benefit. So a 10-cent drug could make so much of difference. No pharmaceutical company will sponsor this trial. So it was, I think, NIH funded and all that. But amazing, amazing. And we can go over the pathophysiology if the time will not permit us. But in the people who do not tolerate spironolactone, mainly because of gynecomastia, eplerenone is a good drug. Inspire the brand name. Again, you see this was done, FSS trial was done in post-MI patients, LVF 40% or less, tremendous benefit. You see the p-values, the more the zeros, the better the p-value is. So it's very, very good. So all patients who have EF less than 35%, class 4 heart failure, or previously class 4 heart failure, should be on spironolactone. And if they are not tolerating spironolactone, then they should be on Inspire-Eplerenone. Post-MI, EF 40% or less, they should be on this. Very, very important. And it makes tremendous difference. Now, when not to use it? And this is the question usually comes. So creatinine 2.5 or more. Now, sometimes we talk about creatinine clearance. So creatinine clearance 30 ml or more. Dr. Hallberg would like this number better than this number. For us, generally, if the clearance is not calculated, let's make sure that even if the creatinine is 2, we have to follow them very closely, their potassiums very closely, but they should be on it. And therapy should include other, if there is any other potassium-sparing diuretic, take that off, amylin or trimeterin, take them off. And if the potassium is 5 or above, do not use it. Life-threatening hyperkalemia was the commonest side effects or commonest problem in these studies. Supplemental potassium is not recommended unless your potassium is less than 4. So our patients are on Lasix, we give them potassium, they are on an ACE inhibitor, we give them spironolactone, never take that potassium off, they are taking the potassium, and every month we see one or two patients coming through our practice or in the ER with severe hyperkalemia when we have to call the nephrologist. And that is very, very avoidable because of most often, that is because of potassium supplementation we are giving, or patients are eating that low sodium salt, that is potassium chloride. Pharmacological therapy will go a little fast. If a patient are not tolerating ACE inhibitors, ARBs because of renal dysfunction, nitrates and hydralazine combination. The study was done in African American patients, and it was in class 3 and class 4 and some class 2 patients also. And there was tremendous difference in all-cause mortality, first hospitalization, and quality of life measures. This was fixed-dose isosorbide. It comes in a preparation in Bidal. Again, tremendous difference in survival benefit here. And if you can see, the curves separate here quite within 6 months, and then they keep on separating. Loop diuretics. Extremely important tool for heart failure management, and mainly when we come to advanced heart failure, it will be further emphasized. So whenever there is a signs of congestive, when there are congestive symptoms or signs of elevated feeling pressures, loop diuretics are the drug of choice to maintain the volume status. And we would like loop diuretics, not thiazide diuretics, to restore normal volume status. The one thing is, in the hospital, we are doing continuous changes in the drug doses. And same thing happens in our outpatient setting. And most of the time, when we see a poor outcome, that means the patient has not understood our instructions clearly. Because it's, okay, you take 40 twice a day, and they were taking 20 or 80, and they get confused about it. Their pill size and other things, they get confused. So we have to be very careful about whenever we are giving instructions to the patient. When there is a poor absorption, torsemide may be a better option. Some people say torsemide is absorbed better, so we can try that. And whenever they are in florid heart failure, usually oral medications don't get absorbed well, and IV diuretics are needed. What are the commonest reasons people are not responding to diuretics are non-adherence. And one we call about, talk about is the diuretic resistance. And the commonest is underlying dysfunction when the kidney is not being perfused. So this may be an indication that the heart failure is worsening. Doses, maximum doses of 600 milligrams of Lasix, we hardly use it unless until we are doing an IV infusion. Bumex 10 milligrams. So we have a lot of room in the usual doses we use and the maximum doses. So if sometimes we need to, we can go on higher doses. People do become deaf with these high doses, so we have to quickly come down on these doses. Digoxin, not much of a role because there's no mortality benefit, but they're very good symptom relief, decrease hospitalization with this, and it's still a good drug in conjunction with beta blockers for rate control in atrial fibrillation. These are the potassium sparing diuretics we had talked about. Now, the other part of this talk is the device therapy, and I'll just go over the basics of it. So if you have ejection fraction less than 35%, and most of the people we see has mild to moderate heart failure symptoms, and ICD is indicated. If they are going for a bi-V pacing, then we can think about giving them an ICD, because most of the indications you will see are common, and we can talk about it with the patient. And 3 to 6 months of optimal medical management is definitely needed before we put the ICD. And ICD has survival benefit. It does not have symptomatic benefit. We'll come to the symptomatic benefit. So it's very important. It's an extremely good tool. It only has survival benefit. So if there are other comorbid condition, if the patient is not going to survive more than a year, we are not benefiting the patient with that. Sometimes you will see that this 3 to 6 months is hard to wait when we see a very poor LV patient had some arrhythmias. It makes us nervous. Nowadays, we have these vests called life vests, which we can use it again. That is beyond the discussion scope here. So where did this come from? Again, these were all happening when I was doing my residency. Medit came, we had Medtronic CEO coming to our residency program giving this talk to us. And you see the lines separate very fast, conventional therapy, half of the people are dead in 4 years. It's or 5 years. It was here 5 years. And ICDs, they survive quite a bit. So extremely powerful tool, and I think we are, it is said that it is underutilized, but we are doing a fairly reasonable job in that regard. Again, in SCDEF trial, they looked at these people who, and they gave amiodarone, there were more deaths in amiodarone than placebo, and the mortality was 17% less, mortality was less in people who had an ICD therapy. And these were the SCDEF patients. Bi-V pacing. The indications for bi-V pacing are patient in sinus rhythm. Now we are still doing some people in atrial fibrillation bi-V pacing, but what we call class one indications are sinus rhythm, a QRS duration greater than 120 milliseconds, and severe LV dysfunction with an LVEF of 35% or less. And persistent and moderate to severe heart failure despite optimal medical therapy. So bi-V pacing we use once we have maximized our medical therapy. If patients are requiring chronic pacing, so they have AV nodal ablation or something, and we have an RV pacing, and they have reduced LV ejection fraction, bi-V pacing should be considered. And there are a lot of studies which are saying that these patients do better with bi-V pacing than simple RV pacing, because plain RV pacing can cause worsening of heart failure. It improves the quality of life indexes, and there are multiple studies, and cardiologist studies have always very good acronyms. Somehow they figure that out, Miracle and Mustic. So there's no grand round where if you put a slide and if you can't read it, so I think I filled my purpose here. This is in the handout. It's showing that all the endpoints in CRT improved compared to the conventional therapy. And to make it a little better, if the patient CRT is when we are just pacing, we are not defibrillating them, compared to medical therapy, they do better. So CRT is usually bi-V pacing. CRTD is when we use a defibrillator. A few points on surgical approaches to heart failure, and we will do, when time permits, and we'll do a complete talk on these advanced heart failure measures at one point. But things are, when do you send a patient for heart transplantation? When you have a severe heart failure, it's refractory, you have a debilitating or refractory angina, or ventricular arrhythmias that cannot be controlled despite drug, device, or alternative surgical therapy. So these are common conditions where cardiac transplantation is suggested. Usually they are all associated with heart failure. One question which comes all the time is, you have a patient with severe mitral regurgitation, and the consult comes, patient has severe mitral regurgitation, has low EF, patient needs surgery. People, this is not recommended, because if you do a mitral valve surgery in people with severe LV dysfunction who has annular dilatation and mitral regurgitation, if you operate on them, they die early. So it is not recommended. The other are like Batista procedures and all those things where in they decrease the LV size. There are certain sleeves and other things which are coming, but they are not yet up to the market. But the LV reduction procedures are not indicated. So these are the two things which I had to tell you. Steve asked me to talk about heart failure with preserved LV ejection fraction. So the careful attention to the differential diagnosis, hypertension, valvular heart disease, what's going on, either infiltrative heart disease. And we have to see if there is any ischemia and if the ischemia is treated or not. So you look at the echocardiogram, the ejection fraction is normal, 55% or above, it's normal. And then they will say it's a grade 1 diastolic, grade 2 diastolic dysfunction. So these are the things we need to do. We need to do an echocardiography, an electrocardiography. If you need to do a stress imaging or direct coronary angiography, depending upon the symptoms. Now, what are the treatments for diastolic dysfunction? We do not have any treatment currently which will say that this is proven. So you do not need to use a beta blocker and get the patient tired if there is no other indication of beta blocker. But people may have hypertension and you may need it. ACE inhibitors, again, you're treating the underlying condition. And if the patients are coming in with diastolic dysfunction, preserved LV function, and they're volume overloaded, diuretics becomes the key. So use the diuretics judiciously. If you know the patient will need 20 of Lasix all the time, then use it. Otherwise, they do not tolerate even 2 liters of fluid, and they will come with heart failure here to the hospital. So, and if you give them too much diuretic, they will be fine, and one day they will have diarrhea, they will be tired, they will be unable to drink their water, they will take their Lasix, and they come in with acute renal failure. At least 5 patients a month, we see them. The use of diuretics and causing acute renal failure, because something else happens. So as long as they can drink water, they are fine, and all of a sudden, they came with a creatinine of 4. So management of risk factors and management and diuretics, that's the key here. This is for you to read. Now, one thing which is in the hospital which we want to talk about is, we have 6 minutes, right? Evaluation and management of acute decompensated heart failure. So first you look at the signs and symptoms and you check a BNP. It's very important, it's a very good tool, BNP. And very few cases you will see that the patient is in acute heart failure and BNP is normal. And those are the patients who are obese. If the BNP is elevated, doesn't mean that the patient has heart failure, but if the BNP is normal, most likely it is not coming from heart failure, apart from certain situations. Hospitalization is pretty much recommended in all situations, but don't let the patient go home even if they want to go. The common things of hypotension, if the creatinine is rising, or if there's an altered mentation. Dyspnea at rest, and if there is arrhythmia. These people are not going to come back if we send them home. Even if they insist, we have to keep them here. And acute coronary syndromes, very high chances of these patients dying if they are not taken care of right away. So these are the highest mortality indicators you can see. And If you have worsening congestion and if the patient is not even not dyspneic, still I think they would be better served in the hospital. Otherwise, they are going to come back or come in the hospital pretty soon. And then they will stay longer, length of stay would be higher. Any congestion, pulmonary or systemic congestion, you need to admit. If there is major electrolyte disturbances, and usually what we see is hypokalemia, get them in. If there are repeated ICD firings, if there is something else going on, if they are sick, COPD, pulmonary emboli, diabetic ketoacidosis, get them in. And if it was previously undiagnosed, you need to make sure what's going on before you send the patient home. And you optimize the volume status and identify the etiology. Very important, identify the precipitating factors. You have to optimize at least the oral therapy where you are going to go. So just don't send the patient IV Lasix 80 milligrams today and tomorrow patient is home. It's not going to work. And education, heart failure education, and we have the whole nurses and all those things who can do it. So that's very important. These are patient monitoring, which we are doing pretty much every day. Every good physician will do these things. The things which we have to be is initial diuretics. First think about diuretics. And sometimes you may have to see a patient twice or at least a daily assessment of volume status. Foley catheter plus minus, if you can live without a Foley, don't put a Foley. Otherwise, you may have to, and daily eyes and O's and weights. Daily weights are a problem in this hospital and every hospital. It's the same as every patient in America breathes 20 in every hospital. So it's the same thing happens, and it's a joke, by the way. So, but same thing happens in our setup here is one day the weight is taken with three pillows, one day with no pillow, one day the scale is not working. So if the staff who are concerned here listening, please make sure the weights, daily weights are accurate. Daily electrolytes, look for side effects. And the biggest thing which you have to look for is renal function. Do not stop diuretics if the creatinine is going up. That is the one single mistake we make all the time. Creatinine is going up and we stop the diuretics. We need to see what the volume status is. And we see that we give them diuretics, the creatinine goes up for a day or two and then starts coming down when the renal perfusion pressure improves. So do not stop diuretics. And if you have to stop diuretics because of renal function is worsening, call our nephrology colleagues. When congestion fails to improve, then what do? You try the volume restriction, you try the sodium restriction, you increase the loop diuretics. The studies about IV continuous infusion diuretics and pulse diuretics, they are pretty much the same. There are three, four studies which came in and no major changes in that. And we have tried in some patients and some patients we have sent to Iowa City about ultrafiltration or hemodialysis ultrafiltration. And the studies have not yet panned out. It has been a thing going on for the last three, 4 years, but recent two studies are not so promising, but that is a part of another talk we'll do later on. Oxygen, do not put everybody on oxygen. If they are hypoxic, put them on oxygen. If they're not hypoxic, don't put them on oxygen. It's pretty expensive, but everybody gets oxygen here, so we can start getting weaning them off. And BiPAP is a very good alternative for people who are in pulmonary edema. Again, lesser used, still lesser used. I think we are pretty aggressive here in this hospital using BiPAP. DVT prophylaxis with either SCDs or low molecular weight heparin. Nowadays, they don't let us even sign the orders or the chart police gives us a call. IV vasodilators. We are not using them quite often, but sodium nitroprusside is a good, and nitroglycerin is good, mainly in hypertensive situations. And these really work if we have good blood pressure or at least marginal blood pressure. But again, this is for persistent heart failure people who are on treatment with diuretics. Inotropes, I'll go take two, three more minutes then. Inotropes, we use them quite often. These are to relieve symptoms and improve end organ function. And usually with LV dilatation and reduced LVF you are using. Are not recommended, I should say, are not recommended in patients unless until we know what their filling pressures are, either by physical exam or by invasive therapy, invasive monitoring. And if the blood pressure is 120, 130s, there is no role of it. We have tried it multiple times, but most of the studies have fallen flat. So blood pressure less than 90s, usually your inotropes will work. And if you look at Optum CHF trial, they gave milrinone. People who received IV inotropes died more. So that's the reason we are not using him on a routine basis. So all the studies with outpatient IV inotropes and all those things failed because increase in mortality. So symptomatic relief is the key for IV inotropes or to tide them over the current situation. So hemodynamic monitoring, we used to put swans in all heart failure patients, and in fact in my fellowship also I used to do a lot of swans for these heart failure patients. Turns out doesn't do any good. So these graphs are on top of each other. It's called escape trial. Too many problems with the usual monitoring with the Swan-Ganz catheter. So you can consider when the therapy is not working, you do not know where you are standing. If the patient is dry, wet, filling pressures are high, low, and if the blood pressure is very low, and if you have to do a cardiac transplant evaluation. So discharge planning is important. We'd go through all the things about medication, dietary compliance, alcohol moderation, monitoring of daily weights. And this, we keep on saying this, and I have heard a lot of grand rounds in this, and this is not done properly. The patients will come back and will have to pay. Predictors of mortality, BUN greater than 43, systolic blood pressure less than 115, and serum creatinine greater than 2.75. If these are the things, patients are going to die. Exercise training is important. Heart failure education, we talked about labels. And end-of-life care. When we have repeated heart failure hospitalization, chronic poor quality, and need for continuous IV therapy, IV inotropes, you talk about end-of-life care. And they should have a plan to manage sudden decompensation if you send them home. They need to know what to do, whom to call. Inactivation of ICDs has to be talked about, and hospice services. I want to end the talk with the note that recently, in studies, we have been start noticing that people who are put on hospice live longer, if somehow they are living longer. And the second thing is hospice is a form of treatment alternative. So it should be presented as a treatment alternative. It's a treatment alternative. So, and I have at least 3 patients now. We put them hospice and they're doing very well. Doing very well means they, overall they are happy with the way things are going for them. So, thank you very much. We went over 4 minutes. Is there any questions? I would be more than happy.